kids. TGIF. It's Friday. We made it through another week, I guess. So as for the chapters yesterday, I asked you to make predictions about what's going to happen to Edward, as at the end of the chapter he was thrown into the ocean and he was sinking down and he was very afraid. I wrote these words for the chapters yesterday. Disregarding was the first one. This is where the kids were asking Abilene, do his clothes come off? Of course they do. He has many different outfits. He has his own pajamas. Edward, as usual, was disregarding the conversation. So you can see from dis is kind of like the opposite of something, like disagree. And disregarding means, regard means like to pay attention to look at. So he's not paying attention to their conversation because remember, he thinks he's all that and he's sort of like in his own world. And then it says, this is when they take off his clothes, including his underwear. That was horrible. Edward was paying attention now. He was mortified. He was completely naked except for the hat on his head. So you can see in the word mortified, it has M-O-R-T, which means death in French. So he was so mortified, meaning he was so embarrassed. He was embarrassed to death. He was horrified that he was in this very undignified position with the kids doing that mean stuff to him. And then in chapter 6, he goes overboard and it says the word blithely. Was being naked, thought the worst thing was going to happen. Oh, I'm sorry. It's at the end of the next chapter. So far above him, the ocean liner. Remember, she's holding his pocket watch, which somehow seems important that she still had the pocket watch. So it's the word blithely. It says, far above him, the ocean liner with Abilene aboard it sailed blithely on, and the China Rabbit landed on the ocean floor face down, da-da-da. So blithely is kind of like, it's like not noticing. Blithe is when you're kind of like, like you don't care, you're happy, nothing ever bothers you. So the ocean liner, obviously, it's an ocean liner. It doesn't know what's going on. So it just keeps on going. And poor Edward is now in the ocean. So now we'll see chapter 7. And I showed you yesterday that it had that picture of the wave. He told himself that certainly Abilene would come and find him. This, Edward thought, is much like waiting for Abilene to come home from school. I will pretend that I am in the dining room of the house on Egypt Street, waiting for the little hand to move to the 3 and the big hand to land on the 12. If only I had my watch, then I would know for sure. But it doesn't matter. She will be here soon. Very soon. Hours passed, and then days and weeks and months. Abilene did not come. Edward, for lack of anything better to do, began to think. He thought about the stars. He remembered what they looked like from his bedroom window. What made them shine so brightly, he wondered, and were they still shining somewhere even though he could not see them? Never in my life, he thought, have I been farther away from the stars than I am now. He considered, too, the fate of the beautiful princess who had become a warthog. Why had she become a warthog? Because the ugly witch turned her into one, that was why. And then the rabbit thought about Pellegrina. He felt in some way that he could not explain to himself that she was responsible for what had happened to him. It was almost as if it was she and not the boys who had thrown Edward overboard. She was like the witch in the story. No, she was the witch in the story. True, she did not turn him into a warthog, but just the same, she was punishing him, although for what, he could not say. On the 297th day of Edward's ordeal, a storm came. The storm was so powerful that it lifted Edward off the ocean floor and led him in a crazy, wild, and spinning dance. The water pummeled him and lifted him up and shoved him back down. Help! Thought Edward. The storm, in its ferocity, actually flung him all the way out of the sea, and the rabbit glimpsed for a moment the light of an angry and bruised sky. The wind rushed through his ears. It sounded to him like Pellegrina laughing, but before he had time to appreciate being above water, he was tossed back down into the depths. Up and down, back and forth he went, until the storm wore itself out and Edward saw that he was beginning again his slow descent. Means he's going down to the ocean floor. Oh, help me, he thought. I can't go back there. Help me. But still down he went, down, down, down. And then, suddenly, the great wide net of a fisherman reached out and grabbed the rabbit. The net lifted him higher and higher until there was an almost unbearable explosion of light. And Edward was back in the world, lying on the deck of a ship, surrounded by fish. Eh? What's this? Said a voice. Ain't no fish, said another voice, that's for sure. The light was so brilliant that it was hard for Edward to see. But finally, shapes appeared out of the light and then faces. And Edward realized that he was looking up at two men, one young and one old. Looks like some toy, said the grizzled old man. He bent and picked Edward up and held him by his front paws, considering him. A rabbit, I reckon. It's got whiskers and rabbit ears, or the shape of rabbit ears, at least. Yeah, sure, rabbit toy, said the younger man, and he turned away. I'll take it home to Nellie. Let her fix it up and set it to rights. Give it to some child. The old man placed Edward carefully on a crate, positioning him so that he was sitting up and could look out at the sea. Edward appreciated the courtesy of this small gesture, but he was heartily sick of the ocean and would have been satisfied never to set eyes on it again. There you go, said the old man. As they made their way back to shore, Edward felt the sun on his face and the wind blowing through the little bit of fur left on his ears, and something filled his chest, a wonderful feeling. You know what it was? He was glad to be alive. Look at that rabbit, the old man said. It looks like it's enjoying the ride, don't it? Yep, said the young man. In fact, Edward Tulane was so happy to be back among the living that he did not even take umbrage at being referred to as it. Chapter 8. I love this picture of the fisherman. So there's the fisherman and Edward when he pulled him out. On land, the old fisherman stopped to light a pipe, and then, with the pipe clenched between his teeth, he walked home carrying Edward atop his left shoulder, as if he were a conquering hero. The fisherman balanced him there, placing a calloused hand at Edward's back, and he talked to him in a soft, low voice as they walked. You'll like Nellie, you will, said the old man. She's had her sadness, but she's an all right girl. Edward looked at the small town blanketed in dusk, a jumble of buildings huddled together, the ocean stretching out in front of it all. And he thought that he would like anything and anybody that was not at the bottom of the sea. Hello, Lawrence, called a woman from the front of a shop. What have you got? Fresh catch, said the fisherman. Fresh rabbit from the sea. He lifted his cap to the lady and kept walking. There you are now, said the fisherman. He took the pipe out of his mouth and pointed with the stem of it at a star in the purpling sky. There's your North Star right there. Don't never have to be lost when you know where that fellow is. Edward considered the brightness of the small star. Do they all have names? He wondered. Listen at me, said the fisherman, talking to a toy. Oh, well, here we are then. And with Edward still on his shoulder, the fisherman walked up a stone-lined path and into a little greenhouse. Look here, Nellie, he said, I've brought you something from the sea. I don't want nothing from the sea, came a voice. Ah, now, don't be like that, Nell. Come and see, then. An old woman stepped out of the kitchen, wiping her hands on an apron. When she saw Edward, she dropped the apron and clapped her hands together and said, Oh, Lawrence, you brung me a rabbit. Direct from the sea, said Lawrence. He took Edward off his shoulder and stood him up on the floor and held on to his hands and made him take a deep bow in the direction of Nellie. "Oh," said Nellie, "here." She clapped her hands together and Lawrence passed Edward to her. Nellie held the rabbit out in front of her and looked him over from tip to toe. She smiled. "Have you ever in your life seen something so fine?" she said. Edward felt immediately that Nellie was a very discerning woman. "She's beautiful," breathed Nellie. For a moment, Edward was confused. Was there some other object of beauty in the room? "What will I call her?" "Susanna?" said Lawrence. "Just right," said Nellie. "Susanna." She looked deep into Edward's eyes. "First off, Susanna, you will need some clothes. Susanna, won't you?" And there she is when she looks at Edward, and Edward's confused because she thinks he doesn't have any clothes. So she has no idea that he's Edward. She thinks he's a female rabbit. So that's the end of chapter 8. And I'm just going to show you a picture of chapter 9, which is Edward wearing this beautiful fancy dress, sitting in a window with a canister of flour behind him. So, and then it starts off. And so Edward Tulane became Susanna. So that's what happened at the end of that chapter. That was kind of cool. So once again, if you want to respond to the words that I write on the YouTube thing that I'm going to put in our classroom, please do. And make predictions. What do you think is going to happen with the fisherman couple? Did you expect him to be fished up, like, and thrown into a big pile of fish, like if he was a sea creature instead of a land creature? Anyway, thank you for listening. And on Monday, we will have another meeting. So we said in the meeting yesterday that we'd take off Saturday and Sunday from reading, but we'll have another meeting on Monday. And then we're going to start having daily meetings, like office hours, so you guys can come. I did get an email from Mr. Flores, and he said, remember, when you're doing your math, I actually did your math worksheet today, the one about the tabletas de chocolate. So I did that one, and when you answer, you're supposed to write full sentences, including a subject with a capital letter and a period at the end and a verb and all that stuff that makes up a sentence. So thanks. Have a great weekend. If I don't talk to you, you can always talk on the classroom on the weekend, and whenever you write a comment, I will respond to you, okay? And Anna too. Thanks. Bye.